Welcome to VATV. Today is September 24th, 2014. VATV is the voice of Vietnamese American from the Greater Boston area, and it is sponsored by Vietnamese American Initiative for Development, known as VITAID. You can follow our program live on every Wednesday from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. on BNN TV network via cable Comcast, Channel 9 and RCN, Channel 15, and also online at www.bnntv.org. This evening will be repeated through Sunday, 5 p.m., Monday at 1 p.m., and Tuesday at 11 a.m. So for today's program, we have the honor and pleasure to invite a professor from Tufts University, along with her colleague, so Professor Linda Tickle Degnan and her research assistant, Ms. Susanna Lee, are here with us this evening. So welcome, and you can call in at 617-708-3290. So, Professor Linda,
yes, thank you.
Could you tell us about this Parkinson's disease? Because we have heard it from Michael J. Fox, the actor, and you know, the boxer
Muhammad Ali.
Exactly. Yes.
And
so, what is it?
Robin Williams.
Oh, yes. So, what is this disease about?
So, this disease is a neurological disorder. Yes. It originates in the brain, and it's caused by an imbalance in the chemicals in the brain, and the effect of it is that it affects movement. It affects the cells that are involved in movement in the brain. So people become slower, they develop a tremor perhaps, and have hard time moving, and these may increase their falls and their ability to do their daily activities.
So what are the symptoms? You mentioned some of the, you know, tremor and all.
Yes. So the primary symptoms are slowness of movement, rigidity, meaning difficulty moving.
I see.
It feels like a rigidity, like a difficult time moving. And tremor. And that's what most people think of is tremor in Parkinson's disease. It's called a pill rolling tremor, which is very distinctive.
So what's the age onset?
The age of onset is in the late 50s or 60s, typically, but as in Michael J. Fox's case, it was in his 20s, I believe. And so it can happen in early adulthood, but it's most common in older, in late middle age and older adulthood.
I see. So why do people need to know about this disease, for prevention purpose or to raise awareness?
So there are many things. People with Parkinson's, people often don't know what Parkinson's disease is, and they don't know how it is different from Alzheimer's disease or even depression. And so it's really important. We're trying to build awareness of Parkinson's disease. So that people know that it's not part of healthy aging. Some people think that Parkinson's looks like the person is just getting old because there's a stooped kind of posture and an increased falling. And it's not just getting old. It means that the person is not moving, and if they had enough chemical in their brain, medication, supplied by medication, they could actually move easier and do their daily activities much easier. And so that's the primary reason that we want to build awareness, is so that people know when they should go to their doctor and say, I'm having trouble moving, and the doctor can refer the person to a movement disorder specialist who is a neurologist. And we have lots of them around here at Boston, which is very lucky.
I see. So do they get depressed when they have this?
People with Parkinson's don't necessarily get depressed because it is Parkinson's, but because of the loss of their ability to do things, they can become depressed. It's also, as the disease progresses, we don't know if it affects part of the brain that is involved in depression.
I see.
But it's generally not considered depression.
I see.
But depression can occur later, either because of the loss of ability to do things or because it affects part of the brain that's involved in depression.
I see. So your research work on this project, could you talk about it?
Yes. So the research that we're doing is National Institutes of Health has funded our research for 5 years to study the social lives and the relationships of people with Parkinson's disease and how their health changes over a 3-year period. There are very few studies of how the daily lives of people are with Parkinson's and how they negotiate their daily lives with this complicated disease. It requires a lot of medication and understanding how to use your medication in order for you to move and do the things you want to do. And so very few people know how people negotiate their daily life, and we're trying to understand it in a diversity of people, particularly men and women. Typically, men have been studied with Parkinson's disease and not women as much because it was thought to be primarily in men and primarily in white men.
I see.
And now we're recognizing that it affects all types of people, women and men, as well as all ethnicities and races. And there may be health disparities in this area. So the research involves coming into our lab, we're at Tufts University in the Medford campus.
I see.
But first there's screening at Boston Medical Center because our neurology partners are at Boston Medical Center.
I see.
And so a screening occurs to determine whether a person has Parkinson's disease, and then also depression and that sort of thing, ability, whether it's dementia, to rule out dementia and, and that. Then the person comes to our lab, the Health Quality of Life Lab, at Tufts University, and we interview them. We interview the person with Parkinson's, and if they have a what we call a care partner, a friend or a family member who is involved in helping them to live with the disease in their home or community, then we also interview that person. And we study both of their lives, how they are negotiating this disease as time changes and as it progresses.
So the screening process, is it a lengthy type of questions that they have to go through?
So a neurologist actually checks the person and talks to the person and does a Parkinson's diagnostic protocol to determine if they have Parkinson's disease. And it takes about an hour, the screening. It also involves checking for depression. People with depression can be in the study and also have Parkinson's disease, so they can be in the study. We also determine their mental status. The person has to be able to answer questions and be able to understand the questions that are coming to them. So if they have dementia at first in the study, we cannot take them into the study, and so we test for that.
I see.
And so that's what the screening. We also want to make sure that they know that it involves 3 years. They come to my lab, the Health Quality of Life Lab at Tufts University, for every 6 months.
I see.
And they are interviewed there. And it involves interviews.
I see.
Basically.
So have you been able to recruit a lot?
Yes, I also want to mention every 3 months, between the 6-month visits, they're given a telephone call just to see how they're doing.
I see, I see.
And what's happening, and also to ask them some questions about their health.
How did you get the words out so that you can recruit these folks?
Yes, so we've been doing a lot of things like this. This is our first television that we've done.
I hope it helps.
Yes, and we're very excited to be here.
Thank you.
And we've also been to many of the Boston community's health centers, the partnered centers with Boston Medical Center and Tufts University. We've also been to many of the housing for older adults.
I see.
Churches. And is there anything else you can think of? Parkinson's support groups for people already who
I
know
see.
They have Parkinson's. Older adult community centers.
Right. We've been offering kind of educational workshops to spread awareness about Parkinson's disease as well. among these communities.
And is there any incentive for folks to join in the program
yes,
at all?
Yes, there is an incentive. Beyond the fact that it's actually nice to talk to people about your life and tell them what it's like to live with Parkinson's, we find that very satisfying to people. And also, they know they're contributing to maybe helping people in the future live with Parkinson's, because we'll use this to help people.
Right.
But there's also a monetary incentive. We give people $350 for the entire 3 years, but $50 a visit is given to the couple that comes in, and
they
can distribute it how they want between them.
Right.
And that's every 6 months. They receive $50 up to $350.
I see.
Okay, yeah, so that's helpful for people to know.
Because
they do have to speak English.
Oh, yeah,
and,
I see.
Well enough for us to understand.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the limitations of our study.
Right.
We'd love to have it translated into multiple languages, but at this time we don't have the funding for that.
I see. So how were you able to raise before? Was it supported by the National Institute of Health that you mentioned?
Yes, so we have our funding, and we have funding for 5 years.
That's
and
nice.
Very good funding to have interviewers, students like Susanna, and research assistants like Susanna, who are participating, as well as many other investigators involved in this study, is well funded by the National Institutes of Health. And they're the ones who have the $350 that they're giving us to give to the participants.
That's good.
Our research study.
Yeah, so if I may ask Susanna, what has been your experience as a research assistant, and why, you know, you're interested in doing this work?
Well, this is my first time being involved in health research, and especially qualitative research. So the most meaningful part of the experience for me has been listening to the interviews from the participants and hearing how diverse the spectrum is for how the disease impacts each person's life. And also, a lot of the times people talk about all of the other things in their life, like their children, what they like to do, how they spend time with their partner. So it's very enjoyable for me because I'm just learning about people and people's lives.
Right. So give an example of the person that you interview or that you work with.
I'm going to intervene a bit because we cannot tell about a specific person because of HIPAA.
Oh, yeah. No, I don't mean the name.
It's
just the person,
but
A, B.
Maybe you can talk about some of the activities you've heard about.
Sure. Yeah. Well, I've heard that some of the participants enjoy doing physical activities such as dance groups or participating in yoga or even just seeing their friends going out to eat.
I see.
Just being able to maintain their activities that they do every day is very important.
I see.
They talk about going out to a restaurant, which can be quite difficult for people with Parkinson's disease because of the tremor.
Right.
And maybe if they have to use a walker or something like that, it can be feeling like people are looking at them. And so they talk about those types of things, but also really how those types of things, going out to eat and being able to be with your friends, are really wonderful, and that they can do that. I'm also we are both occupational therapists.
Oh, I see.
And we're in the Department of Occupational Therapy at Tufts. We also give tips to people on how to do those kinds of things, but after they're involved in the study, not really while they're in the study.
I see. Yeah. Well, we have 5 minutes left.
Okay.
So I want to make sure. How can people contact you?
Okay. Well, the first contact occurs with Kathy Thomas, a neurological nurse at Boston Medical Center.
Yeah.
And I have a phone number for her contact.
Yeah, please.
It's 617-638-7737.
And so how many more people do you want to recruit?
So we have 60 people with Parkinson's already enrolled and their care partners. Mm. And we would like to enroll another 60 people with Parkinson's.
That's easy, right?
Well, we hope we'll have that done by the end of March.
Okay.
Okay. Of 2015, all right. This coming year. So we're trying to do that. And then we follow each of them for 3 years.
Yeah.
So
it's a long duration.
Yeah. So we have that target, and we have really great, we send newsletters to the people who are involved in our study so they know what's going on and keep them abreast of what's happening in the study. Mm. And we develop relationships with them so that it's something that they really can benefit from.
So since we still have some time, what have been some challenges that
yes,
you have faced
yes.
in reaching out?
Some of the challenges we face in reaching out are language barriers, for
yes.
example. That we can't do the translations. We would love to do that. And maybe in future studies, once we see what's going on, we could do translation. Translation studies take 2 years to develop.
And
that would take a longer time for us to do. So that's one of the challenges. The other challenge is that we have so many interviews.
Yeah.
We're interviewing people all the time. And so it's a coordination process. And to help accommodate the times that people can come in, because some people are with their care partners who's working, or they are working themselves with Parkinson's disease, and we want to be able to try to coordinate at a good time, an evening, a weekend, or during the day, and so those have been some challenges. Can you think of some other challenges that I'm not thinking of? It's a very large database, but that's a science challenge, and you're well equipped for that.
Yeah, yeah. And the reward for you in doing this work?
I can talk about that.
Okay.
My grandfather had Parkinson's disease, and he was a lovely person. He joked and told me stories and sang, and I really was influenced by him to enter the field of occupational therapy and then start researching it. And so I find it very rewarding that we're finding lots of help for people with Parkinson's, and the research is contributing to that.
Wonderful. Yeah, thank you so much. So, we only have a minute left. Thank you. We hope that you can come back in the future so that you can talk
follow-up. Can I give the phone number?
Oh, yeah, again? Please repeat again.
So the phone number again is Kathy Thomas, and it's 617-638-7737.
Okay, thank you so much. So for tonight's program, if you have any question or make any comments, please send it to VidAid at vatv@vidaid.org, or you can call at 617-822-3717. I hope you enjoyed the show tonight, and we look forward to having you at next week's Wednesday show. Have a good evening. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
What a difference a difference.